Good evening. Tonight we host one of our last public events. It's a lecture with participation of Anders Harm, Estonian curator. In the frame of our program called Edu-Art 2020. In the frame of this program, we have organized a course of contemporary art and curating. And the last module, this is the 10th module, is or was dedicated to the curatorial practice and also artistic strategies of working with of work outside of institutional context or outside of big institutions, let's call them traditional cultural institutions, and experimenting with spaces which are more like hybrid spaces or not exactly very defined from juridical or I don't know social perspectives. I will introduce shortly Anders, whom we got to know some time ago and who already have been lecturing in Chisinau. Some of you maybe were part of the curatorial training course in spring, which we organized here in Chisinau. Unfortunately, this time we have to do it online due to pandemics, but we hope to be able to continue meeting in person in the future. Anders Harm studied art history and theory at the Institute of Art History at the Estonian Academy of Arts from 1995 to 2003. He is currently a freelance curator, lecturer of contemporary art and curating, and the head of the curatorial study programs at the Estonian Academy of Art. In the years 2009-2015, he was active as a program director of the self-acclaimed Do-It-Yourself Museum of Contemporary Art of Estonia, EKKM. In the years 2002-2012, he worked as a staff curator at the Kunsthalle Tallinn. He is one of the establishers of the new performance festival in Tallinn, and he has curated Estonian Pavilion, both of the art and architecture, Biennale in Venice. He also published collection of essays and other texts under the title Diary of a Semionaut, texts from 1999 to 2008. I will stop here, and I think Anders could share more details about his biography with us. So, Anders, we are very happy to have you as a guest lecturer, and I give you the word. Thank you. And maybe just to precise about the format of tonight's meeting, we will have a lecture of about 1.5 hours, and we will have a break afterwards, and a seminar will follow. So those of you who would like to participate more actively in the discussion are invited to stay with us afterwards. Thank you.
Yes, thank you for this very thorough introduction. Was exactly as Vladimir said, I was in Chisinau in this spring, and it's now seemed like a lifetime ago, so ages ago, and it's like it was probably on the last minutes of before the total closure of Europe that we were able to meet there, and we enjoyed it very much, those who were present in this previous course. So what I'm going to do tonight, I am going to introduce some performative actions taking place in the public space of Tallinn from the years, let's say, to 1998 to 2016-17, and it's not so much about the curatorial activities this time that I'm talking about, but more the artistic strategies and the ways of working with public in the conditions where your budget, let's say, isn't that high, of course, what has interested me for a long time is actually the this kind of the radical subversive action and the city as a kind of an embodiment of capitalism or the modern city as the embodiment of capitalism. And I will now switch on the presentation. Here we go. So, and of course, in order to talk about the centrality of the city in the modern era, of course, we can't avoid the Situationist International that was active from the 1957 to 1972. But of course, I mean, the cityscape has been, kind of synonymous with the modernist movement already from the beginning. So, so what the modern painters of the modern life painted was actually the city and the importance of this kind of unconscious or subconscious of the city was also very, very important for the surrealists. And for the futurists, it was a political arena as well as to the Dadaists. So the city has been kind of the central configuration of space, let's say so, for the modern era. And of course, the ones who articulated it most precisely were the Situationists in the 50s and even before the Situationist International was formed. So as I already said, that they saw the modern city as the embodiment of capitalism. And as one of their early mentors, Henri Lefebvre, said, the modern society is the urban society, meaning not only that the urbanization has been the clear indicator of modernization, but also that urbanism overrides every aspect of rural being as well. It extends and transforms the country life as it does with the city life. So, so the urbanization of the whole society has been this kind of the key thing that the Henri Lefebvre has stated, so that the urbanism is not something that happens in the cities, but it is something that is perhaps which we can perhaps state about the society as a whole. Situationists then believed, and Guy Debord was the leading figure behind the Situationist movement, was of course he went to the lectures of Henri Lefebvre and was clearly influenced by him. And Situationists and Guy Debord as the leading figure, they really felt that the modern metropolis was a clear image of the divisions and segregations of that the capitalism created in the society, alienating the subject from her everyday life. The center and the suburbs, the industrial areas, and the trade centers, the peripheries and the slums, the gated communities for the super rich and so on. All this, the city itself reflects the social order of capitalism, or so the situationists believed. And the subject, who is totally subordinated to the structure of the city as well to the structure of the capitalism, only moves on narrow trajectories between home, work, shop, and never experiences life and the desire. And situationists thought that the ultimate revolutionary task is to free the homo ludens, free the desire, and make a human or the man play again, make her drift in the city, get new unexpected experiences and create ambiances. And in order to transform the world, one needs to get in contact with one's everyday life, go beyond the passiveness that makes one numbs a serve of the society of spectacle, as the board named the society, or the modern capitalist society. And in order to fight that oppression of desires, one needed to create situations, practice drifting, write psychogeographic reports, and make suggestions how to transform the cityscape. So I hope that if you are not familiar with these notions like the drift or situation or psychogeography, we can have a small introduction to that as well, but please let me know if that is needed, or the situationist discourse is relatively well known, I would presume. So, shall we do it or no? Do I get an answer to that?
Yes, that would be nice.
Okay.
One comment was also yes, please.
Okay, good. So, one of their central concepts was drift, and the drift in French it was dérivé, or so basically it means a kind of erratic movement through the city, walking almost like a flânerie in the modern times, but. So in order to get to experience the city differently, and this was practiced by the situationists under this kind of a psychogeographic umbrella concept. And the psychogeography, of course, is the notion that basically is the comes from the two notions, psychology and geography. And basically what it meant was the influence of the geography to the psychology of the man. So and this was basically the aim of their drifting agenda. So they formed, for example, two groups. They were having walkie-talkies, and then they started to drift just aimlessly through the Paris city and be in contact with each other, talk to each other. And after these walks, they formulated reports. So for example, in one of their reports, they suggested that the prisons should be open for the visitors. The rooftops of Paris city should be bridged so that people could walk on a different level, that all from the city names, the saint, so the from all the city street names, the saint should be liquidated, and the churches should be demolished, and art should be exhibited in the in the cafeterias and so on and so on. So what they aimed for was the total transformation of this kind of subjugation of the subject into his or her trajectories when one only moves like from home to work to shop and then back again, always the same trajectories, and then sits the whole night in front of the TV and being this kind of the true servant of the society of spectacle. And of course the television was the ultimate embodiment of that spectacle then. So situationists ceased to exist in 1972 after abandoning art completely and becoming a revolutionary group on the eve of May events in 1968. So they, from the 50s, when they were like heavily part of the kind of artistic movement outside of the gallery and gallery system, of course. So that's what they always denied. But then they also, in the 60s, the early 60s, they Guy Debord started to extract the artistic part of the movement in order to become more political, and divided the situationist movement into two sections. So the right-wing section that included artists and the left-wing section that included the political activists, more or less, and they were very active part. And some say even that the most influential part of the 1968 student riots and some of their texts were the most published texts that actually led to that riot. But after the events of the May 68, they were actually totally forgotten for almost 2 decades. Right until the end of the 1980s, where the rock critic Grail Marcus wrote his very famous book, Lipstick Traces, A Secret History of the 20th Century, which basically is a book where he traces the history of punk movement back to the Dadaists and to the Situationists. Of course, sometimes it seems like extrapolated and totally unfounded roots, but nevertheless, the book itself is very interesting. And also, at the same time, in 1989, there was a huge retrospective exhibition of the Situationist International, also in the Pompidou Center. So this kind of momentum was created by these two events. And after that, I think that in the 90s and also in the zeros, the Situationist became kind of the most talked art movement of the 20th century, I would say, so from this kind of the radical movement, and they also, I would say, influenced the artistic practices of the 90s already then in this kind of post-socialist, post-Soviet situation. The collapse of the Soviet Union and the Eastern Bloc opened up also the cityscape as a playground most intensely for this kind of the post-Soviet and post-socialist artists from the Eastern European countries. And in the Soviet time, basically, the public sphere or the cityscape was only free in theory. So basically, you could heavily be punished if you ever intervened into the public sphere. So that's why, for example, the most famous action group in the Soviet era, the collective actions, under the leadership of Andrei Monastirsky, they did their activities only outside of Moscow, because it was totally impossible for them to operate in Moscow. So here is probably one of the most well-known, just an example, probably one of the most well-known actions. It's a slogan using this style of the, as they were used in the May parade or October parade in these kind of official terms, in the official occasions. And basically the text is this kind of the poetic text, probably, I assume everybody there can read Russian, so I will not need to translate it. But it's a kind of, the message of the slogan is totally opposite of this Slava KPSS or any other slogan that you would normally expect from this red background, white letters banner. And usually their practice was that they organized a small collective that would travel outside of the cityscape, where then some very small scale performative action or this kind of installative action would take place. And of course it came from the fact that the city scape was much more ideologized than the countryside. So the countryside was more or less free, or the control over the countryside was much weaker than it was in this kind of huge public spaces in the city. So their strategy was very, very clear due to that. So in order to avoid the conflict with the power, they moved to the countryside. In Estonia, the things were rather different. So some of the happenings actually happened in the city as well, but more or less also it was heavily controlled. And for example, here is the happening papers in the air, very innocent play with the papers, burning papers in the at the beach area in Tallinn, in Pirita. And basically somebody complained about their activities and they were imprisoned for 10 days just for doing that, from just fooling around basically. So so this was something that could happen, you know, when you did an action in the Soviet era, in this kind of in the city limits. So most of their actions and actually took place outside of Tallinn. So, but Pirita beach is inside of Tallinn, and that was where they got punished severely. Also, the other kind of safe place for them would have been the premises of the Art Academy, or the Institute of Art, as it was called. But that's another story. But just to give an understanding of the city as a kind of a negative space or unavailable space in the Soviet era, which was only meant for the, you know, the official rights that could happen there. This, of course, totally changed in the 90s, and also for the Soviet or the former Soviet artist, the public sphere became available. So here is Alexander Brenner's very well-known Russian nihilist artists or actionist artists, most famous for doing the dollar sign on the Malevich's white and white painting in Amsterdam, but this is one of his actions in Pushkin Square in Moscow, where he basically performed the sexual acts with his former girlfriend or girlfriend at the time in front of the Pushkin's eyes. So this kind of subverting the Pushkin's romantic agenda with this brutal sexual act. Or Anatoly Osmolovsky also here dealing with the public sphere, sitting on the shoulders of Mayakovsky's statue, also in Moscow. So the action itself referring to the Jonathan Swift Gulliver Travels, of course. So and he recited the words of Isaac Newton: "If I have seen further, it is by standing on the shoulders of giants." So it was can be interpreted also in a way that basically the giants or the return of the this kind of the post-Soviet era, or the post-Soviet era itself was kind of a land of the midgets, let's say, or the society of the midgets, that only and basically so all the great deeds were done before that era, and Mayakovsky was one of his great heroes. And another example of Brenner's activity is his performance in the Red Square. Believe it or not, that was possible in 1995 in Moscow, where he stood, basically addressed Boris Yeltsin, the Chechen War, and the Orthodox Church, and stripped down to a pair of boxer shorts, pulled out the boxing gloves, and began going through the motions of warming up for a fight, shouting, "Yeltsin, come here! Yeltsin, come here!" So, in order to invite Boris Yeltsin to solve the political problems with one-to-one fight. And this is also his understanding of the this kind of total democratic action. So one-on-one fight is a fight without any kind of power technology. So, you know, one is stronger than the other, of course, based on the raw power and who has more strength and so on and so on. And naturally that happened also in Estonia, that the cityscape became a kind of a vital field for the activists and artistic activities, and one of the greatest fights was, of course, about the memory, and so probably you all know that most powers, when they change, they try to also to eliminate all the monuments of the previous power. And this power change, of course, in the 90s, in the early 90s, was no different. Most of the monuments of the Soviet era, they were demolished and removed, but this one remained. And it remained mainly because the fact that it was actually a grave monument. So it was an eternal fire. It was this kind of the Monument to the Unknown Soldier, or the deceased in the Second World War, as it was reformulated in the 90s. But this monument remained, and over the years it became a kind of a symbol for the minority Russian culture to commemorate their deceased ones in the war. And of course it became a kind of place of heavy, not heavy at that time, national conflicts, which then culminated in 2007 with the removal of the statue and the reburial of the soldiers' remains to the graveyard, the military graveyard. But in 1998, Hanno Soens did a performance on the back side of this monument. So I will show a short clip. The first of his series of actions in the public urban space in which he articulated the associations and relationship between place, work, memory, and personal bodily experience. This was a period when the issues related to the monument were not so politically acute as they were 8 to 7 years later, although various ideas about what to do with the monument were already in the air. Just Steve Reich's phrase come out to show them from Soens' performance soundtrack, which repeated at the beginning of the action, as well as Meredith Monk's hysterical laugh. I still have my memory, I still have my mind, I still have my philosophy at the end of the performance are not coincidental. The pink character that adopts a pose similar to that of the soldier on the back of the monument, the gaze directed at the banana instead of the eternal flame, which had been extinguished a long time ago, creates a delirious and absurd connections, internalizes the entire public space pregnant with meaning and secrets personally in a personally redefined psychotic versions. So it was kind of a reverse, literally the action on the back door of that soldier, and also this kind of deconstruction of the concepts of the male concepts, let's say. So this kind of queering of the male as well, not only the city space, but also this kind of dominant image of the male presence in the culture that and and so on. So. But not only that, of course, there were this kind of the absurd connections and the the consumer society, whatever metaphors that the bananas perhaps show, and so on and so on. So it was much more diverse than this kind of one directed or clear statement, just in order to create a personal, private space on the back door of this monument dedicated to the strength and courage and so on, all these characteristics usually associated with being a proper male specimen. And after, right after the, or during the same time when the bronze soldier was finally removed, basically they started to campaign in order to put up another monument, this time for the War of Independence, 1918 to 1920, which they finally did in 2009 in this horrible cross shape that is now standing in, on the Vabaduse Square, which means the Freedom Square. And of course, in the in this kind of public awareness, this monument, even before it was done, was called the Freedom of the Monument of Freedom, not necessarily of War of Independence. So in 2008, when the process to in order to erect that monument was started, Flo Kasearu, is an Estonian artist, did a campaign on the Vabaduse Square itself. It was a kind of a guerrilla action, of course, where she put up these posters stating freedom, Vabadus, and we declare the competition for the best solution. So kind of an alternative competition for the monument, and then basically this people in the city could then fill the blanks or put come up with their own solutions for the monument. So here is the, for example, one statement, "Ta ei tule nagunii," which basically means that it's not coming anyway, that so meaning that the freedom is not coming anyway. The middle one say is play with the words, so vabadus, vagadus. So vabadus meaning freedom, vagadus meaning piety. And the person has just simply eradicated some of the text in order to state that, that the piety, the best of result of our competition with an exclamation mark. And of course, the last one is self-explanatory. So what does the freedom actually mean in today's terms? It's the total society of control. And so the memory walls aside, the another kind of big topic of the late 90s, early zeros action art in the or actionist concerns were the was this tourism, and tourism of course is a kind of a packaged experience of a city, kind of city as a product, and I will now show you a small clip also from the from this performance by the filmmaker Marko Raat and the art historian Andres Kurg, titled "The Stone Tour," and basically Andres Kurg, it was done very soon when he graduated Art Academy, and he operated in Tallinn really as a as a tour guide for tourist groups. So that's how we used to make money in order to support his life. And he was also an architecture historian and curator at the Architecture Museum at the time, but that wasn't obviously enough. So so what they did was that they took a real cruising tourist from the America, or the USA, and they made a stone tool to them. Basically, it was a totally fictionalizing the Estonian history around this kind of stupid concept of limestone that was declared to be an Estonian national stone. And also, so they, so I show you the clip.
Well, hopefully the weather today is good. All the city itself is built of limestone. This is the national stone of Estonia from the year 1992, the very symbol of Estonian nationality. And as I said already, then the national stone being limestone. And also there are small animals who lived once, this, like fossils who have remained in the stone. So if the stone is our national stone, then also the small animals could be like our national animals. To the left, we pass then one another important monument, that is the Viru Square and the Viru Hotel. It's very easy to remember. Viru, it's just like virus, but without the S. Quite a nice building, but unfortunately, it's not of limestone. Another then comes to the right-hand side very, very soon, a magnificent large palace erected in 1992, just a year after independence was declared, and that is the president's castle. Very soon will be, yes, and here it comes to the right-hand side. We'll be able to see the building erected then by the local people for the president in 1992. And of course, using the same traditional limestone again, the local material can be found from the areas up here.
Well, this of course wasn't a presidential castle, and it wasn't built by the people for the president. That was the National Library. So it was kind of experiment on how easy it is to create an image, a certain narration of the of a certain place and what the tourism itself does. It actually takes a certain areas which it calls valuable, and then the other areas which it doesn't. So usually in Estonian case, it's the medieval city center that is declared valuable, and as if the life ended in the 14th century. So everything else is considered of less value, and so on. And here it is actually a work by Neeme Külm. It's untitled. Basically, it's just a wood pile, and it is an installation in the old town, in the city wall. And that was actually part of the project that I curated, one of the first projects that I curated in general. And And basically what Neeme did, it just brought in this kind of the rural element and just closed this one gate in the city wall. And basically the idea was to, you know, see how the people would react to that. Will they, you know, march through it or, you know, try to get past it, or will they ignore it and just find another route? Or, you know, we were hoping them to act on it somehow. And they did, of course. But that meant that they called to the police and the city government, and they asked what this is about, all about, instead of, you know, trying to put their hands on it and try to work themselves through it. And of course, I mean, it wasn't like we were blocking something vital as the only entrance to the Tallinn city. Of course, it was not the case. But people who worked around this area, and they were very angry with us, as if we were, you know, closed something of the utmost importance. But this is one of these kind of, you know, early Northeast situation strategies. So this was also something that they did, and we tried to kind of block this kind of touristic trajectories to make obstacles to that course and so on. And here is another strategy. It's an action by three architects, Siiri Valner, Indrek Peil, and Heidi Urb, called The Waste of Tallinn. So Tallinn usually is not a very big city, but it's a kind of a long one. But also it is very narrow in the middle. So they search for the trajectory that would be the shortest from one end to another end of Tallinn, and they found that basically from the sea to the Ülemiste lake, it's these orange areas here. Between these areas, there is only 2.3 kilometers route, and they made a tour along that route, trying to go straight from the sea to the lake. And here you see some images of that. So this is also a kind of a practice of practicing alternative tourism in your own city, and also getting to know your city from a totally different perspective. So really applying the situation strategies to it. So they led a group of something like 50 people all together through this straight line. And early zeros, I would say, was this kind of highlight of this kind of city and public space related artistic activities, the activities outside of this kind of institutional frame. And one of the outcome of these practices was the A User's Guide to Tallinn book that was edited by Andres Kurg, the same architecture historian that you saw in this stone tour video, and Mari Laanemets, another art historian and curator. And in 2003, they put together a kind of an alternative Tallinn tourist guide, which explored the city in a totally different manner as the usual tourist guide do. So it went to places no tourist usually goes, to this kind of the Soviet era blockhouses, for example, as you see here, and to the areas related to the various subcultures in the 80s and 90s and 70s even. It took a tour around this kind of cult bars that were still existing at the time, and so on. So you see here in the lower picture also some subjects that they talk about, so graffiti and beggars and skating. So also they see, you know, the city from the skater's perspective, for example, and they have very young skaters who at the time, young skaters who then describe the problems of the city from their perspective, and so on and so on. So it was a completely different tour guide as the usual, concentrating on the old town and the medieval times and so on, and this kind of medieval kitsch that ruled. Now we, of course, live in a totally different environment, and we have got rid of the tourism, at least temporarily. But let's see what will come. And of course, I would say now that there was also a trend of this kind of straight political actions in the city space, or this into the city structure, that were on the verge of illegal actions, and this was one of them. The white stripes on tarmac was actually the protest of the students of Art Academy at the time in the 2005, that forced the people to cross the streets or go underground in order to cross the street, and while the cars were, you know, running on the street. So in one night, they actually they used chalk in order to make this crossing in front of the Art Academy, and it started to work immediately very well. I mean, the car stopped and let people to cross over, and there was no problem with it. But I mean, there was in the newspaper at the time, they said that punishment for this kind of activities that could harm people's lives were about two years imprisonment. So they went really far. But basically what they wanted to say is that this state with this action was that the city is not for the people, but for the cars. And not for the pedestrians. So what they demanded was the better cityscape, the better city environment, let's say so. And there were other similar actions that took place at the same time. And now I jump in time a little bit further. It's another action by Flo Kasearu, and this time together with Andra Aalo, and it is not in Tallinn, but taking place in Maribor. And basically what they did was that they clothed a bunch of actionists into this safety guard uniforms, and made a city tour that was really a guided city tour in these uniforms. And basically it was, of course, the times of the heavy mass immigration and so on. So this kind of this question of security and the safety of the streets and so on was politically extremely charged, and this costume drama, of course, created a lot of suspicion. Why are all these guards going on the streets? What are they doing? What are they doing there? Why do they go to the, you know, supermarket in a bunch of 20 people and so on and so on? So this was kind of playing on this the fear and the embodiment of the fear with this very simple, actually, actions, as probably all of these actions have been. And one of the huge topics, I would say, is also the guerrilla gardening. It has never been very fruitful in most, it's something that emerged maybe in 2010s. So the past decade, when people started to recognize that it as a kind of an important issue, and the trajectories of the food and so on. So this was merely a symbolic action that they took, this kind of a desert of a deserted green area in between this Lasnamäe channel that was peak. So they planted barley weeds there in the spring, and then it became this kind of installation by the summer, using the stairs of one bridge, the stairs that actually lead to nowhere because people are not allowed to use these stairs. And of course, this is now very famous Lasnamäe channel. The people who have seen perhaps the film Tenet that was premiered this year might have seen it in that film as well. Anyway, it is so, and now I come to the final example of the Estonian origin. It comes from the also from 1999, and basically this is an action by Mari Sobolev, together with some friends, where they used TV1, as it was called at the time. They used to just to show in the nighttime the Pirita Road as a kind of a permanent video installation, and Mari and friends decided to use this free air time in order to go there with the slogan and try to stay in the air as long as possible. And the statement was, as the title of the action, freedom of speech, so sõnavabadus in Estonia. And I will, since it's very short video, I will now show it fully.
Yeah. see roosa maja.
Jaa. Ma seda kartsin kogu aeg.
See on eriti tegelikult, kui me nii lähme.
Ma unustasin oma selle, ma võtsin, et ma võtan kaasa oma avaliku selle ürituse loa.
No näed sa.
Aga no see oleks muidugi tähendab nii ilja ilmselt, kui kinni võetakse, see väga aidanud, no kui, ma ei tea.
Me oleme praegult Tallinna Spirita teel TV1 maja juures.
Ja mida me siia tulime tegema?
Me tulime siia tegema poliitilist aktsiooni, mis peaks minema otse eetrisse, eetri omanike tahte vastaselt.
Ühesõnaga otse ajalu.
Põõsaste vahelt läheb sinna tee äärde ja siis minema sinna vahe peale keskele, kus on see haljas riba ja siis minema selle loosungiga, loosung laiali laotatud liikuma sinna poole, kuni ütleb meile telefoni teel Mihkel, et me oleme nüüd kaadris.
Ja siin otse reportaasilt TV1 maja juurest. Oleme varsti alustamas oma rünnakut ja minul said just jaad märjaks. Meie eesmärk on seal. Aga õudselt uutunne. Ja mina liigun. Nii, nüüd ma... Ja kus see pilt peatub? Ja, mina lähenen kohe varsti. Ja, seal samas... Ja. Ja, kõnniteel on pime, kahe tee vahel on valge. Inimesed, liikuge. Ja me oleme teles. Ei, ma karjun siin inimeste. Nii edasi. Lindistad sa. Põhimõtteliselt loeb välja. Niimoodi väga hea! On me? Ütle kui asja ära kuskub. Okei.
Okay. Alaris kossa, bandiera rossa, triumfera. Bandiera rossa, triumfera. Bandiera rossa, triumfera.
E viva!
La libertà, rossa. Bandiera rossa, bandiera rossa.
Alaris kossa, bandiera rossa, triumfera.
So, basically all these actions are very simply, very situationist in a spirit, I would say, using not very expensive tools, not very expensive materials, the materials that are available at any time, and using, appropriating the situation, so the turning them, as the situationists would have said, in their favor, creating ambiances in the city and creating a different kind of experiences in the city, and working on a very different, in a very different directions. But in 1999, Kalle Lasn, who is a Canadian Canadian author with the Estonian roots, so he was actually 2 years old when he fled Estonia in 1942, I believe it was. And this is a book he wrote in 1999, so approximately the same time when most of these actions that you saw today were done. So some before, some after, but and it's based in his practice as an activist. And the term describes his practice, how to fight neoliberal capitalism in an over-medialized world, using the same channels and methods as the capitalism itself does. It is basically a handbook of a micro-revolutionary, a meme fourier, who causes confusion and paradises trademarks, doing campaigns and organizes, you know, public letters and initiates public movements. So Lasn has never hide the fact that he considers himself as an heir of Dadaism and Situationism, converting some of their strategies into the or converting them for the contemporary times. So what they do basically is create grotesque visions of the current states of affairs, like Dadaist did, at the turning or hijacking media images and so on. And so the culture jamming was basically his strategy of how to fight capitalism in the media world, so kind of jam its machine basically with the different strategies. And he, in 1989, he started Adbusters magazine, which is a very famous one, of course, anti-capitalist and anti-consumerist magazine, together with his friend and partner Bill Schmaltz. And the reason why they did it was very simple. So they were trying to air their film where the forest against the forest industry, using the same channels as the forest industry does, in order to show themselves as a caring business who takes care of the forest rather than abuses it for capitalist purposes and so on. So they tried to buy airtime in different media channels, and they were refused. And as an answer to that, they came up with this Adbusters magazine, where they basically publish articles that kind of analyze and criticize the consumer society, and also they turn around this kind of. So they are the true original meme warriors, basically. So they it can be said that they started the started to fight capitalism with using or turning around this kind of slogans and memes and logos and so on and so on. And one of the probably most famous campaigns is this Buy Nothing Day. So as you know, in America, the Black Friday is this kind of the orgy of consumerism, where basically people run to the shops in order to buy Christmas gifts and so on. And they started to campaign against that, so that you would not go and buy anything, especially on that day. And of course, one of the most recent endeavors, so they were actually the force behind the Occupy Wall Street movement. And so it started from the Adbusters magazine and then became a movement where also other groups joined in and so on. So Adbusters corresponds rather well to the changes that took place in the 1980s in the order of capitalism, the rise of the consumer capitalist brand logic, the neoliberalization of the production, the decline of the welfare state, the rise of the transnational corporations, and so on, where the main battleground is not the street, but media, and the main enemy, not the governments, but corporations. So they were quite certain that in order to bring down the master's house, you need to use the master's tools. So in order to, you know, fight capitalism, you should use the same tools as the capitalism does. So advertisement, marketing, and so on, and so on. But in reverse, so you should kind of reverse their messages and use that against them. So this is kind of in a way, it's an opposite to the situationist strategist, where this kind of radical refusal of participation in the society of spectacle and interventions and so on and real experiments were endorsed. So what he does in the context of the 80s is quite different, I would say. Endorsing the fight in the media rather than in the streets, until the Occupy Wall Street, of course, which is kind of a return of the street as a political arena, I would say, in many ways. But also the Adbusters have been criticized a lot. So they have been, you know, accused of being too violent, because one of the Montreal group of Adbusters thought that Buy Nothing Day was not enough, and they created an alternative day, Steal Something Day. So basically some groups went around and stole stuff, some other groups went around and puked in the shopping malls, corporate shops and so on. And at the same time, I mean, I don't disagree with that at all. I think it's just they're fun pranks. But what I consider a problem perhaps is that while promoting not buying, they have launched their own anti-capitalist fair trade sneakers brand and so on. So they are, of course, I mean, they claim it's a fair trade, and but they have become part of this capitalist machine themselves. But I think that the main problem is elsewhere. They seem to use the strategy that Ernesto Laclau and Chantal Mouffe have called the chain of equivalence. By joining together different topics and themes of different social groups in order to join them in this kind of the equivalence, the chain of equivalence. In order these themes, to get more volume together. And I quote him, "We are very diverse tribe. Our people range from born again lefties, to green entrepreneurs, to fundamentalist Christians who don't like what television is doing to their kids, from punk anarchists to communication professors, to advertising executives searching for a new role in life. Many of us are longtime activists who, in the midst of our best efforts, suddenly felt spiritually winded. For us, feminism had run out of steam. The environmental movement no longer excited. The fire no longer burned in the belly of the left. And youth rebellion was looking more and more like an empty gesture inspired by Nike. We were losing. Then we had an idea. Maybe we bank together these heads of all these activists and reconfigure the fragments forces of identity politics into a new empowered movement, we could start winning again." So the idea was probably to politicize masses beyond the usual left-right liberal conservative axis. And perhaps in some questions they can agree as well, but can one imagine a fundamental Christian supporting, for example, LGBTQ rights, the lesbian, gays, bisexual, and so on, and Occupy movement that united many different organizations was actually financed by Robert Halper, the supporter of Mitt Romney and the one who actually belonged to that 1% that the 99% stood against. So that was actually the whole point of the movement, to fight them for the taxation of the super rich. Halper saw it as an anti-Obama agenda, but there were no interest from the Occupy groups who were perhaps against some of the Obama politics to support the ultra-conservatives, rather the opposite. So Chantal Mouffe has said that the chain of equivalence must have limits. In order for the chain of equivalence to be established, you need to define a common adversary. What is going to unite this is the definition of the common adversary. So in the end, you need to have a frontier. I always insist that politics is necessarily partisan and that politics is about frontiers. That is why I feel that right and left are still fundamental categories of politics. Of course, not in an essentialist way, that this is always the right and this is always the left. Without the partisan character of politics, you cannot establish the limits of the chain of equivalence because you are not able to define an adversary. So basically what he says that, or Chantal says that this kind of chain of equivalence, if taken too far, can become totally inefficient. In 1999, Alexander Brener and Barbara Schurz published a book, What is to be Done? 54 Technologies of Resistance Against Power Relations in the Late Capitalism. That was also a kind of a handbook of a street fighter and a radical actionist. As they themselves called it, a number of semi-anecdotes and semi-reflections about the possibilities of political and cultural resistance under the conditions of the globalized market and multiculturalism. So I hope that you have time to read this text today. So I will not go in very deep details with it, but in order to to make a conclusion, and we can discuss this opposition between this kind of Lasn and Brenner and Schurz in the seminar. So that was my idea to discuss these agendas. So in 2004, when we organized a poetry reading for Brenner and Schurz here in Tallinn, where they were residing at that time, they chose to title it Master's Tools Cannot Destroy Master's House. And at the time, I probably didn't notice that, but the more I think of it, it was actually in order to create a dialogue or opposition with the with Kalle Lasn, whom they knew was an Estonian by birth, at least. So, so I see that their strategy, the total refusal of media and documentation and so on, in order the action to be authentical, is very clearly oppositional to Kalle Lasn, where one should, you know, enter the media and enter the society of spectacle, or enter the spectacle in order to create an anti-spectacle within that spectacle. So here the cut is very much clearer, and I would say that this cut, that their practice is even more, is in a way seeing itself as a continuation of situationist practices, and this kind of even returns to this most nihilist forms of Dada, perhaps. So so they demand totally different things from the action, you know, connection with the specific location, the body against the machine. So any kind of, you know, machines in order to weaponize the body are eliminated, and so on. So boxing, that's why the boxing was very important, because boxing doesn't include any other technologies except the body. So it's a kind of you know, one-to-one action. Of course, it can be criticized as an ultra-macho strategy as well. I mean, and this kind of wild antisocial activities that they promote. So using everything, this kind of you know, stones from the street, the mud, the flowers, dirt, hunger, and so on. So even shit. And then striving for decomposition and unproductivity. So any kind of products, results of these actions should be denied. And so it is, in a way, it is more jamming than actually the cultural jammers produce. And so there is also the refusal of any aesthetic and ethic satisfaction, and so on and so on. So, however, on the rhetorical level, it sounds quite promising, but based on their activities, it is actually concentrated heavily on the art world, and which ultimately actually demoralized their position, I would say. Their activities depend on the art world, on which they became the parasites. So they became kind of desperados, like Bonnie and Clyde of the art world, romantic and self-destructive rebels, but just on the backside of the art world. So they never really went with that into this kind of society of the or the reality. They never entered it. And now I just yesterday looked up their practices, what they're doing now. And so they have an exhibition in Johannen Museum, and they participate in the Steirischer Herbst, which is a kind of a, you know, Austrian most celebrated and one of the most famous cultural festivals and so on. So they have it seems like they have totally given up on their agenda and fight against this kind of neoliberal art system. Like Brenner called it in 2000 when he was doing a graffiti at the opening, entering the manifesto opening and doing a graffiti action there together with Barbara. But this is now what I propose for the discussion is that but talking of the radical action today, isn't it so that we need both strategies combined, living in the augmented reality, which actually creates a possibility for small and powerless actions to stand out and become viral and so on? Since the technology is part of our everyday life, it would be very hard to deny it. And paradoxically, in order to resist, you need to adopt it somehow. Technology is not only the master's tool anymore, not solely at least. And as much as it is possible to build a society of control with it, it is also needed and possible to use to resist it. Black Lives Matter movement got started with the help of a mobile phone, basically. So in order to spread your words, you don't need to buy airtime anymore. One can easily use other channels. So there is no dominant one-sided Big Brother, which of course has created the world of alternative realities and alternative facts and helped the bigots to power and gave them voice as well. But since it is this heterogeneous world now, documentation of actions has ceased to be fully mercantile activity. It might help your case, for example, when you're arrested or in case to spread your message, because action is always kind of a liminal. And using or incorporating technology might help you to create a larger virtual community and extend your change of equivalence internationally, and find you know, friends and colleagues and co-workers from outside where you are located. So I think that we should reconsider both of these two strategies in order to, you know, come up with the strategies and methods and maybe also rules for the action today in this totally new conditions of media that has emerged in the in this last decade. So with that, I will end at the moment, and perhaps as I understood, we are going to have a break at the moment, Vladimir.
Thank you, Anders. Yes, I propose to have a short break, 10 to 15 minutes, if everyone agrees, and go back to the discussion after this, if you feel fine with that?
Yes, so everybody can gather dots. I mean, I'm sorry, it was a bit heretic, but I just, you know, wasn't what I exactly initially thought I will speak. But I changed my mind quite late, and I hadn't really time to work it through properly. But I hope it was possible to follow these ideas. So I see you in 10-15 minutes then.
Yes, let's meet 5 minutes to 8 and yes. Continue. Thank you, okay. Everyone.
Yeah.
So maybe we slowly go back to the to our activity. Let's see if everyone else is more or less ready. I hope so.
Yeah.
And Anders, would you propose would you describe a little bit how do you see it?
Well, I would first like to hear your if you have any comments or questions, and perhaps we can start from there. Concerning any of the actions or concerning the general idea of a kind of a radical artistic political action today. Well, because I have also more questions than answers, so that's
I will try to write down the question just to put it in the chat so people can have it as reference. So, are there any questions concerning any of the action or any?
Or if you want me to specify something where, you know, something remained unclear. Because they don't know any of you at all. So I was just trying to.
I think Anastasia wants to say.
Yeah, I remember there was a question earlier in the chat about that the artwork with the banner on red with the letters, and maybe it would be good. To translate it somehow?
You mean collective actions? Collective actions banner. Okay, let me see if I can get it.
Yeah, not everyone speaks Russian here.
Okay, sorry. Yeah, I was so, why, that was very weird for me to assume that. Vladimir, you speak so much better Russian than me, or Maxim, you can do it. I mean, I could do it, but it wouldn't make any sense.
I can translate it, but I still would like to understand it, but because I don't understand it.
Yes.
I don't complain on anything. I like everything, despite the fact that I have never been here and I know nothing about these places.
Yeah, it's. It's a slogan by Monastirsky, one of his books, and there is actually an answer to that as well, where he kind of argues with that statement that he doesn't know why he told that he doesn't know anything about this place, these places he knows very well, and so on and so on. But it's I think it's a kind of just a poetic text, not necessarily related to much, just to oppose the official language of the slogans, which is very affirmative, very clear. You should do this, you know, hooray to that, and so on. So this is very doubtful and dubious text, and so there are like many corners to it. So. So there is not too much to it, I would say. more, or as much as I've understood. And they have also collective actions. They have a collectivne действий. So they have a website also in the basically where all their actions until today, and they're still active today. They still continue to do. The last time when I watched, the last action was actually in October last year. So perhaps they have done something more since then. But yeah, so you can get acquainted with their activities, basically from the beginning on. Does that clear something?
Yeah, thanks.
So, what concerned me with most was that, and I realized actually too late that this kind of the city action, for example, in the Eastern European countries has died out. I think that the city that was the most visible of these post-socialist wounds, and everybody, I think that all the artists in all over the Eastern Europe, actually in the 90s and early zeros, addressed the city space as an environment, as a kind of a place where to, you know, articulate their actions, and also which they saw as a public, still as a kind of a public sphere, or that there was a possibility to make an action there. I think that in many ways this has died out, except in Russia, of course, which in the past decade had this new wave of radical public action, you know, Pavlensky and Pussy Riot and Vojna and so on. I think that everywhere else it is more or less kind of finished, which is sad in a way, because it seems like artists don't see it as a important issue. To intervene into the cityscape and into this politics of publics, or how do you see it from your perspective there?
May I intervene? I actually think quite the opposite, that the city became one of the main battle arena here in Moldova, at least, and it concentrates most of the issues and the power relations. So I think the the city space and urban space as a kind of context is one of the main topics, at least for us, like. Mm-hmm. For us, it was one of the main topics during the last 10 years. Mm-hmm. And we encouraged artists and curators to work with this issue locally here, but mm-hmm. also we connect to other artists and cultural professionals from other post-socialist cities to see how they deal with their own environment. And the topics can range basically what I could see is that there is the one of the main topic is, of course, commercialization of urban space, of public life, mm-hmm. so on, and the commercialization of the city, and the city as a huge billboard being used by anyone, actually, but from political force like parties to commercial companies. And so we kind of miss the citizen in this environment and the opportunities for inhabitants to express themselves, to become more more visible or present in public life.
I was kind of hoping that you would say that, because that was also my experience with you the last time. This is an important issue, and that you are genuinely into this kind of the street level, the grassroots level politics, and combining that with the arts, which was genuinely extremely inspiring for me, because I kind of missed that here, because we used to have it, as you understood from the examples, but it's mostly from the turn of the century, you know, end of 90s until the late zeros, I would say, and after that is like this total decline in this kind of interferences in the public sphere, so that very few, and they have been done mostly not by the artists, but then by these kind of the students, you know, for example, the crop action or the crop installation was done by the students of the interior design of the art academy, so not the art students. And also the architects have been active, both students and this kind of real architects or graduated architects, in order to address the urban issues, which of course for them is also a question of, you know, professional question, the quality of the city space and so on. But then again, like missing totally the artistic intervention into the space. So in a way, as we have seen, this kind of the return of the street politics, you know, since Tahrir Square and all this kind of Occupy movement all over the world, the Arab Spring and ending with Occupy, it hasn't really brought back the artistic action in the streets, you know. But my question is it because of the lack of institutional space, the institutional frame, or is it because this is something that the artists in Moldova feel that they are engaged, or they that this is like a topic that is very close to their heart? Or rather, they do it because there isn't much else they can do.
It's both. It's like there are two reasons, I believe, for that. On one hand, there are no contemporary art. There is no contemporary art infrastructure like galleries and contemporary art museums and so on that would create this safe space for artists to exhibit their work and to sort of to stay inside, indoors. And that I see also as a kind of positive provocation, because it made the cultural community to think what other options are there that could be employed, like public space. So public space became one of the opportunities in this case. But on the other hand, this total commercialization of public life became a very visible issue, because it touched probably everyone. It wasn't that it was affecting just some part of population, but actually it touched those who live in neighborhoods, in residential areas. They lost all kind of infrastructure, like cultural spaces, green spaces, and sport grounds. All this was gone. But also those who live in the city center, just in a different way. For example, the architectural heritage started to disappear, or it became overcrowded with cars, and there was no even space for walking. So you could feel like limited as a pedestrian, as a citizen in any of these kind of situations. And this kind of impact is very visible. Mm-hmm. And affects you on a basic level, like of your ordinary life, it's being affected. So even if you are not an artist, you sort of become aware, if you are not thinking usually of this kind of topics, you become aware of this new context, and especially in capital city like Chisinau, which concentrates again everything, all these interests in one single place. But what I wanted to say is that I think as artists we were more sensitive to this kind of transformations, urban transformations, because this wasn't exactly part of our profession. So I have to formulate it differently. Like an architect would still work as an architect even in this new urban environment. He would still get commissioned projects, he could build this neoliberal type of architecture. But as an artist, we kind of were free to reflect on the, because no one would commission us this kind of, yes, of course, there was publicity. Mm-hmm. The publicity was the main domain to involve a lot of artists and so on. But so somehow we could detach from our kind of classical education and look at the situation around in a different way, and to observe this radical transformation. So what happens now actually is that as artists we support other movements, or we sort of join new urbanists rethinking the city in a more friendly way, or joining some social protests and mm-hmm. or for balancing for reducing inequalities so basically we have maybe a secondary role now, because there are new movements which formed in the meantime and that reclaim this kind of, One more maybe detail which emerged during this last 10 years of work was that we didn't deal just with public space issue and the urban transformation, but we kind of interconnected it to public sphere. Mm-hmm. And we saw a direct relation between the two. So one idea is that we cannot have a democratic public space if we don't have a democratic public sphere, and vice versa. So these kind of two things were related. That was, maybe this is going back to your first question, what kind of strategy for future is like, maybe not to think in one dimension or another, but to see the relation between these two and the kind of to trace better the transformation, urban transformation, how do they affect public sphere, or see if public sphere is like to, what happens in Moldova is that it belongs mainly to parties, so there is very few independent media, to understand how this kind of situation impacts the urban space and the living environment.
Mm-hmm. But then perhaps something to connect the, you should this kind of start your own media and then to publicize your own actions there. This is something that would probably, make use of this new media situation where everything is a king of the, king of television, basically.
Yeah, the answer is probably that we have to be both active in the street and in the public sphere, and to mm-hmm. have a sort of islands of freedom mm-hmm. in both. And be present in both places, spaces.
But you have, any of these, these strategies or the examples that I presented made any sense to you or at all. I wonder if for example, this kind of extremely nihilist the approach of Brenner, for example, is kind of a very productive these days. Can it, you know, can something of it, of his like total refusal of, can be implemented into this kind of the strategies? And then of course, Kalle Lasn's or the Adbuster strategy, which is hugely expensive. I mean, it's basically no one can really afford that in order to, you know, produce on that level in order to fight with the same tools back to the, I don't know, whomever needs to be fought. So what do you think of that?
I would let others to answer maybe, and then I would go for it.
I wanted to comment from point of view of member of active art collective and somehow link it to this 1977 slogan performance in Russia. So somehow I feel that art collective sometimes also traveling outside of city in order to be free to do something, while sometimes back to city, and now I'm comparing Prague and Kishinev, sometimes I dream that inside city I would find several bookshops, like in 1977, I could buy records, and I could visit theater cinema and several cinemas. So, when you were mentioning the situation and somehow describing, I think it always have more poles, and of course we could be seen like very sentimental to the time, which rather my parents remember very well. But even now I have friends from former West Germany, which remembering visiting Prague in 80s. So somehow these older friends describing me Prague, which I don't remember, and they were astonished by the culture possibilities, publishing of records, of classic music, quality records, theater, books, and so on and so on. And somehow I feel these times with Kolkhoz, our collective, what we don't create for ourselves. Sometimes we end up with small fishing table in front of closed and always closed and dark palace of culture in Kishinev, in center of Kishinev, standing in front of the closed palace with thermos and somehow simulating some institution which works for artists. I think we are in much more bigger vacuum, and we still have to travel outside of the town, and in town we don't find what we might be found in 77, which is maybe great stimulus, I would say, at the end.
I think that, of course, Prague in 77 is totally different from Moscow 77 and Berlin 77.
Switch of sound.
And because I think that there were like in the Soviet or the socialist era, let's say, there were like at least three different worlds within this socialist sphere. And I would say that and one of them was, of course, Yugoslavia, which was like a world in itself. Then there was this kind of the Visegrad countries, Poland, Czech Republic, Hungary maybe also, that and then there was this kind of the Soviet Union. So I think that all and maybe German Democratic Republic also was perhaps closer to the Czech Republic than to the Soviet Union. So I would say that in Soviet Union the situation was really, really hard. I mean, especially in order to work in a public space, to work in a public sphere. So that the you know, the apartment conceptualism didn't born from an empty space. It was a kind of an ultimate necessity in order to exist as an artist, if you wanted to do something, you know, in Moscow. In Tallinn, you could, you know, do things. You could be part of the official art world. You could exhibit, and even some like radical exhibitions took place, but not in Tallinn, but of course in small places outside Tallinn. So that was totally different. And so I would, having studied a bit, not much, this kind of the Soviet or socialist era Eastern European art scenes. So I would say that the Czech Republic was kind of in a very good position in terms of freedoms, in terms of, you even had galleries. Poland was, of course, the most kind of liberal in that sense. So they had like an international galleries doing international programming, all this kind of important Western conceptualist at the time traveled to Poland to do things there, you know, and so on. So, and of course Yugoslavia also, they could travel everywhere. So the situations were completely different in terms of life in the public for the people in Prague, and of course, I mean, Prague was probably the Paris of the Eastern Europe in these days. Of course, I don't remember that myself as well. I mean, I was very young when Soviet Union ended, but based on my reading of the Eastern European tendencies, I would say that this were the case, that the worlds were completely different. And but concerning this kind of the, you know, the statement of the collective actions, I would say that it is a remarkable statement in many ways, that it states a totally different kind of feeling of place, and totally, you know, it's kind of relaxed in opposition to this kind of very tense activism of the 90s, you know. That so they had very many weird actions that they did in the countryside. So and they were usually very short. So the most important thing about these actions was actually the travel itself to this spot somewhere outside, and then the thing itself was, you know, just a turning point, and so they traveled back. It usually lasted something maybe 20 minutes, and then it was over, and then they traveled back. So this was the travel itself was a performative action, you know. It's kind of to travel outside this limited, confined society. That's how it probably worked in the 70s. Boris Kreis has actually written also about that, especially of collective actions and how it functioned. So it, and of course the audience was very small, that they had something like 20 people max, 20-30, usually friends, because outsiders would have been already a possible threat to them. So, you know, if that would have found out that something like that was happening somewhere, they probably would have canceled it. But since it was, you know, countryside, it was okay. Okay, they would have done it in Moscow, in part, for example, then it would have been totally very, very problematic.
And you listen to me?
Yes.
I think what connection, for example, now and Soviet time, it's that can be good artistic also task, find a place for self-expression. I mean, we understand limits that we have, for example, and this Moscow conceptualist, they understand limits, and not only objects, and not only what they do, but where they do start to be part of a concept of this artwork. And maybe it's close to us because we research city urban environment with such questions like what we can activate or where we can do in our work. Okay, for example, we have now some many marketplaces, but how we can, for example, use this environment for our work? Because you can, like artist, like person, I don't know, integrate in different institutions, in different environments, and you can be, for example, just use this like service or like open space, but in same time you can image this like space for self-expression. And for example, for me, important questions about ethic and aesthetic in such spaces, mm-hmm. in public spaces, because for me, in aesthetics somehow should growing from ethics. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you come with your personal aesthetics to place that already have some aesthetics, and you put your manifestation for provoke social context, of course, social context answer to you to this provocation very clear answer, and you can you know what answer before you do this. So you understand, if you if you provoke, of course the other side will fight with you, and it's clear even without action. So for me it's a bit boring because you already know answer how what will be with you. Yeah, but for example, if you start, mm-hmm.
so that object, for example, Brenner's action, because you know that the outcome is violence on both sides,
mm-hmm.
that it will not lead to anywhere, like into a third place,
yeah,
something like that. That I understand completely.
Yeah, and. Okay, maybe once it's interesting, but when you repeat and all time see this answer to your provocation, start the same somehow, and you don't make step next step. But for example, if you really interested about place or society where you live, and you can somehow exchange and start to understand this aesthetics through use this. For example, like Moscow conceptualists, they're using this form. But put their content inside, and somehow from this they deconstruct these Soviet patterns through you. Because before you start use this, you don't understand. You can fight, but with fight you don't understand with what you have deals. And even if you speak about marketplace or abundant Soviet infrastructure, if you won't learn what it was, how it's work. If you don't fight with this cheap, maybe plastic, maybe sometimes some aesthetic of that, something opposite of intellectual imagination, and you start, okay, let's try playing this game, let's try use these knowledges, use this imagination about what is beauty, what is not beauty, maybe you learn something new about with whom you speak and with whom you live together in one place. In time where all media context try provoke us through this everyday see all slogans, all these manifestations, Black Lives Matter, All Life Matter, this is good people, this is bad people, blah blah blah, and in this time of non-stop provocation, maybe create organizing space for communication, it's more radical that fight, like all fight around you. So it's question about what is radical today. And
what is radical today?
Huh?
What is radical today?
Yeah, it's it's question that I all time have when because I think radicalism very connection with context, and like artist, if you repeat radical practice from 17th, it's not don't mean that now it will be radical, for example. Very important how you read and how you create dialogue with this context. And of course, for this, I think best maybe form of for me best form of research it's this find situation or create situation for communication with even what I don't understand or maybe criticize or maybe afraid this is very intuition way because you don't have clear rules or some instructions how have deals in public space. You have some understanding how you can work in gallery, for example, in this clean, sterile conditions, and you can make many things. You can make provocative things. You can make somehow you understand, and people study for this. But when you go to social some context, to public space, you understand that, okay, exist formal rules, but between people exist some rules that don't write nowhere. You can just maybe sometimes listen, sometimes feel something, try repeat for beginning, after understand some mechanism. And this research start be also art, like artwork or some this result. That sorry, Victor, some performance make them. I think it's very experimental way, and I for example don't have ready made answer to them, and many I prefer don't know that clearly understand what is good, what is bad for me, for city, for society.
So you should somehow open the possibilities rather than kind of close them in a kind of this kind of a confrontation. Is that?
Yeah. Because I think this classical format of artist, like a position of person who know, he know what he won't say, he know what. It's position of curators, position of God. You already know some construction exists inside you, and you just work for. Finish in some point and you won't see some construction that you already prognosing somehow. But my point of view opposite, I prefer don't know, and for me interesting open some situations and see how I react, not only provoke people but see what I will do in this situation, how I answer, how I speak with people, and it's like some open final time. You just start, and after you see, such things.
Mm-hmm. Any more comments?
I was interesting. I came later. Hi, Anders. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I have a view, everything, and for me, it's question as an artist from this pandemic time. It's quite difficult to understand your strategic plan or strategic as an artist. I return to your art work that you show in the Soviet period, made by Monastirsky and Collective Action. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they go outside. Of the city because it was censura and you can express yourself And now we have the same situation. We must sit at home, not to go somewhere. And a very nice example was exhibition made also in Moscow, but they made outside of this Moscow, made by a quite famous curator, Erafeyev. And he made an exhibition created outside in some court space, and it's called Chacha. And also it's referred to the collective action that it's time to go out. You can't express yourself in the space where you live. But at the same time, we see a lot of demonstration and people to protest against this, that we haven't liberty, we haven't right to do what we want to do. And for me, the question to you, how you see the artistic tragic now? For you, for example?
Yes, I mean, I somehow missed that fun that we had, perhaps in the early zeros in the city, because it was very, very playful as well. It was not like a totally, you know, confrontational, because it really opened spaces up for things. I remember one thing that we organized together with some friends in the early zeros at one of these kind of huge land art monuments. It was really like taking several hundreds of square meters, maybe thousands even, and we just tried to organize a party there, and the party was starting at the sunrise, so it was something like maybe 5 a.m. that the party started. And then of course we couldn't get our this generator working, so it was all basically, we were without electricity, and people started to make music with whatever was there available, and it was probably the best party I've ever attended to, because everybody was a musician and everybody was a participant and everybody danced and everybody made some noise, and it was without any amplification. So probably some, I mean, this was kind of the strategy of this kind, also the counter publics. You use something, some places in the public sphere against that what they are intended to. So, and we kind of, we practiced that at the time. These days, to answer your question, I don't know. That's why I'm also trying to discuss this, because probably, I mean, things have changed a lot. Also the conditions of actions have changed, and probably it's because of this significant threat of the, I don't know, some kind of a terrorist threat, whether it's imagined or real. For example, there are definitely certain things that wouldn't be very healthy to do, you know, in the public sphere that wasn't there actually, not, you know, especially in the 90s, but also after the 9/11, it took some time when the public sphere became more a scary place. You know, certain terrorist attacks in Europe had to happen before that actually started to crawl in a way. But the fear was taking over, and we were not, you know, that free in the city as well. So, but yeah, I mean, in the end of the 90s, for example, the Reclaim the Streets movement, which started this kind of street race and started to take over the highways and organize events there, it reached also Helsinki. So it was kind of like this growing and expanding all over the Europe, and it reached Helsinki. And I was able to participate on one of these first events. So it was a party that was also a political event, because it just, you know, stated that the cityscape or city space is for people, not for, you know, cars and bureaucracy and so on. And it belongs to everybody, not only to private owners and so on. So it was a totally different cultural environment, I would say, in this this period, which now somehow seems to be lost, especially after all these kind of the great street revolutions, you know, Dahir ending into a totally, you know, Islamist takeover of power and things like that. So Occupy dying out, which was also meant to be a revitalization of this kind of the turn of the century, you know, anti-alter globalist movements with the slogans that if I can't dance, I will not be part of your revolution. So this was the really the spirit of this kind of turn of the century relation to public political action. And somehow this is, I don't feel it anymore, right? It wasn't so much present in the Occupy movement. And the past decade has been really, really, boring even in terms of public actions. So not necessarily do I miss Brenner's screaming everywhere or this kind of utter violent interruptions, but also this kind of the positive usages of the public sphere and are somehow missing, at least looking from the European perspective, or not, also trying to think out of my own, like the Estonian context. So I think that it's up to you guys there to do something about it, because I see that the spirit of this situation that is on the one hand that you're anyway outside of the this kind of normalized art discourse, and you have to work on the street, but it's also a strength of you, because this is also opens up the possibilities to engage differently with the publics, great different publics and so on. So which in this kind of boring gallery art context where every exhibition is a repetition of the previous one and you always see the same people who go there. So it becomes a kind of a loop in itself without any productive value that you have. If you work on the street, you become, you always meet somebody whom you haven't met before.
You can hear me, right?
Yeah.
I wanted also to stress this idea that maybe we need to find a different audience, and that's maybe one of the, I mean, of course there is no one single strategy today, it could be probably a lot of them. But rethink the audience and the publics is one way to go forward. And on one hand, to go out of this loop of same people coming to your event and bubble. So the working with public space is offering this kind of opportunity. And the other is also to escape this kind of control, which was created through the public culture infrastructure.
Mm-hmm.
Since, especially in Soviet time, we could feel it that there is a circuit of spaces, and the content, cultural content, could circulate just through those spaces, from houses of culture till museums. So one way is to go out of this commodified situation and escape control of first and the censorship in order to circulate new kind of content, but also to engage new audience and new people and create an audience which is maybe more related to what we do as artists. And also having contact with the ground, as Maxim explained, is like is learning from the, from the city, from people using the city. So it's like a process of self-education, and it's not about coming with a specific message, but it's like starting a new thing, but having as premises not Art Academy, but the street. And then the street is like the school. And that's where we start learning as artists to what to do next. And it gives us a sort of direct relation to the context, not a learned in books relation to the context. And so we kind of win 20 years, like before it arrives into the books and then goes into the school program. So I think the one of the strategies is to create this kind of, I don't have answers, but I believe is to multiply the voices and to multiply situations so that, let's say, the elite cannot anymore control the multiple voices and multiple situations and infrastructures, temporary infrastructures, temporary collectives being formed here and there. Like a bench could become an art space or an experimental space. And all these ephemeral infrastructures, actions could actually win by quantity in front of you probably cannot really control 90% of the movement of people, so you can control a part of it, but a lot of it will escape control and still reach the public sphere in a way or another. It will parasite like the guys putting a banner on the TV. So if you have this kind of happening everywhere, it will become a multitude of voices which suddenly will create a new wallpaper in the background of those TV cameras. So that's kind of maybe we can reach that kind of effect. And it is also opposed to this logic that let's take the power and then we do the change. Because like basically you start a revolution in order to produce a change, but maybe it's not the answer anymore to do a revolution, but rather to overcome the control through a multitude of all sort of actions, and of course artists could be contributing to this. And one more field of action I feel is education as a public domain, and which is more and more commercialized today and kind of commodified for producing professionals who would basically serve the industries, the cultural industries. So how to rethink the educational field, since it's still being funded publicly, it's like one of the last probably public resources which is not yet private, not yet privatized. And it's if we lose the field of education, I don't know what else will be left as a kind of accessible public resource which could be used by artists, by cultural workers. So yeah, Edu-Art, which we do, is sort of trying to answer this kind of situation and to propose to rethink the education works as well. So it's more like, an experiment, and we try to experiment with different formats, But at some point, this kind of learnings could go into the public curricula eventually. Mm-hmm. Maybe, Anders, you have your experience with Art Academy in Tallinn. You could tell us more, how does it work there?
Well, I mean, the changes have been very dramatic, and since I work at the Art Academy, and we are now in the new premises for maybe it's a third year now, and for 7 years the academy was spread throughout the city, and before that we had a building that was done in '60s. And that was demolished. And probably, I mean, what the students feel, and they have been trying to address that, is that this first, that the new architecture is not supporting this kind of collectiveness that it should. The house, which is actually designed by very young architects, the graduates of the academy, that they have not thought that this space should create a collective, not to separate everybody, you know. And it is like, basically, we are all working in this kind of totally illuminate environment, in that sense that everybody sees everybody. So it's kind of a total nightmare of panopticum, in that sense, architecturally. So all the classrooms are covered with glass, and you see people there, but there isn't really a social space within this academy. Like we had, for example, the bar in the old one, and which actually was because the unofficial education is very important also, that you get through the interaction with the different students and from the different faculties, and that you mingle and so on. This academy new space doesn't really create that. So, for example, one of my students this autumn, she curated a project in order to convert one of these locations in the academy into this kind of social space for the students to interact, to lay around, to, you know, to come together, because the public space within the academy that was meant to be like a general, be used by everybody, is not working, not functioning at all. And she managed to do that rather well. I mean, this, and she had a program, and she had performative events throughout the week that she organized together with the artists. And now this academy saw that it works, and they kept the place. So now it is the most popular spot in the academy. Everybody, all the students spend time there when they have free time between the lectures and classes and so on. So I think that this is one of the aspects. What concerns the education itself, that my experience is that in our situation, there are more possibilities beside the education, or you can do the education also using the art institutional system, because we have it is a rather developed one compared to other countries, even Latvia, for example. So we have different institutions. They are rather well funded, and also that, you know, you can have some things that I spoke about last time, that it's actually possible to do this kind of thing that is completely your own initiative, and it is possible to make it run. And so there are a bit more possibilities, but I consider education very, very important because, but this neoliberal academy is very resistant to any kind of extracurricular activities, interactions, because it wants products. And that is the another reason, perhaps, why this kind of the spirit or the mentality of the academy has changed so much. This kind of the bohemian spirit that was very important part of the academy, that made the academy before the demolition of the previous building, is somehow lost in these 10 years that we didn't have the premises. But the educational system actually, it started, I mean, when I studied in three schools, basically. It had three names during these years that I studied. So it was State Institute of Art, then it was changed into Art University, and then it was changed into Art Academy. So basically, so you can imagine how many reforms there were also besides the changing of the names, because everybody thought that it's a very good idea to, you know, change something all the time. And then, of course, the Bologna system hit heavily, so this 3+2, but still, I would say that as this kind of old bourgeois notion of this, you know, education as a kind of vital tool for the citizens and to somehow exist and participate in the society. So that still somehow lives on, but and you can like use it against it. And I also always say that it's not about education; it's about sharing. Like sharing the experience, which Charles Escher, I think that he was the one who said that, you know, it's not that, you know, you come and you teach somebody like thoroughly that this is that, like this and that and that. No, it is that you share the experience that you have, which is something completely different than the normal or the official understanding of the education, what the education should do. And I also don't think I have the answers, ready-made answers to give, but I have certainly tried to articulate that perhaps there could, you know, be some ways to develop the practices which would make more sense. And to tell you the truth, I don't think in many ways that some of the practices that I encounter here, for example, make that much sense when I see that, okay, perhaps it instead of the gallery or instead of the art academy, this should happen somewhere in the public sphere. That it would be much more efficient there, and if we could somehow to bring it to the public, then perhaps it would be more efficient in many ways, encountering new audiences, sharing the knowledge, and also gaining the knowledge and discussing. So it is all part of that public practice as such. So it's not about only the intervention into this kind of, or violent interruption to the public sphere, but rather than creating something around which, you know, the discussion could be created. And especially, so why I tried to bring the media part in it was that perhaps this kind of situations that where we are now are not over with this in 6 or 7 months. Perhaps they it will be something that will be present always, and we should also think of creating publics more intensely here, you know, and using the virtual space more for different things. So yeah, but it...
exactly, I totally agree with you in, and also that's why we host a public program as part of Edu-Art. So Edu-Art, of course, is aiming at practitioners, at people who are interested in the subject, but we also try to open it to wider audience.
Yes.
In, I mean, today it's mainly online because of the restrictions, but the intention was to have it all like as public like a platform for discussing the issues and talking about kind of topics that maybe are of concern to other members of the audience as well. We don't have that much time left. I believe it's kind of late also, and if maybe someone else would like to...
I'll be soon thrown out from the academy because, you know, in the, when I studied in the 90s, it was open 24/7. You could always come. And now it, they closed at 10. That's also part of this, what is totally wrong with this place.
Yes.
But, yeah, sorry.
Anyone who didn't talk would like to comment or expose, present his or her view. If not, I have a question, and it's somehow related to the curatorial part, which we didn't talk that much. Basically, one question would be, what are the strategies, or like one of them you mentioned, just your student opening this space inside the Art Academy. But what kind of strategies as curators we can have today to advance our agenda or to make visible certain things? Often when it comes to exhibiting ephemeral actions like the ones that we saw today, which are just documented, how to deal with this kind of situations, because what is left is mainly documentation. We cannot really, or, and should we curate, like, should we actually curate white walls, or should we look also for other spaces where to exhibit art?
Well, I think that we should actually curate public spaces, and and through that also create the public sphere, as you mentioned. These things are connected. So that's what I, that's why I think it's important to so that this local dimension is present, but also this kind of public sphere is created through this action, through the medialization of this action that that is now possible, that we can actually reach out to people and create something with these tools, to use them, not to be, you know, so afraid that we document something. I mean, the documentation is, I should be not demonized as Brenner does, you know, because this is also, you know, part of your possibility to communicate your things, is to, okay, to show them, to spread them around like that. And, but yeah, I think that what we should create is rather this public, because this is also what Alain Badiou says, that there is no public sphere as such that exists in itself somehow. The public space and public sphere is something that should be created. Through the practice, not to take, you know, that it somehow exists as granted. That's what I feel. And we can do is to bring the interested parties together, especially the interested parties like the artists and the activists and thinkers and so on. So this is what is important, and also address certain, you know, like local people, because it is more or less the action can only be local. In that I agree with Brenner that there is no universal formula how to make an action, because it is always in some place that it takes place, I think. Did we get somewhere today?
I hope so. And yeah, just as an announcement, tomorrow we will have a shorter session from 7 to 8:30 with Anders Harm. So if you want to share your work, either artistic work or curatorial projects, we have created the space for, mm-hmm. for like more intimate discussion. So, and I believe Anders will be happy to give you a feedback on mm-hmm. your projects. But if still there are one more question, I think we can still have it, but probably the last one, if anyone is willing. Maybe Christina would like to. To address a question or a comment. We spoke also about education dimension. Maybe you can share the Yash specificity.
Yes. You should switch on the microphone, I think.
Yeah, hi Anders. Hey. Hello. Yes, I had a question earlier, but I am not having a stable internet connection, so I don't know, can you hear me okay? Yeah, okay, maybe I'm lucky. So I was wondering, because you talked about this concept of the chain of equivalence or mm-hmm. chain of ambivalence, I don't know, I haven't heard exactly, but as I understood it, it describes a sort of in which, as you mentioned, a fundamentalist Christian is placed in the position to advocate LGBT rights. So I was wondering if this connects to Chantal Mouffe's theory on agonism, because Chantal Mouffe introduced this category of agonism as a political relation that is not radically conflictual, but not radically consensual. So it gives an agonist relation in which political opponents understood each other. Each party understands the reason of their opponents, mm-hmm. and they admit that.
No, you're lost. Christina, are you there?
Yeah, it seems the connection is not very stable, not stable enough. I think we can invite Christina also tomorrow, just to mm-hmm. see if she mm-hmm. finds a better spot, and eventually you have time till tomorrow to formulate an answer, Anders.
Yes.
Okay. Otherwise, I'm. My duty is to thank you very much for this opportunity and for your lecture.
Thank you. I would have actually preferred to be there in person, but
and answering our questions and yeah. Mediating this discussion. Let's keep in touch for the future and. See for other opportunities to meet in person. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, see you tomorrow for the portfolio review workshop. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye. Bye.